is looking at you, kid.
Welcome to the Global Columbia Collaboratory and the Global Seminar for the Collaboratory. I am Dr. Shannon Marbicas, Dean of Global Engagement at Columbia University, and I'm so excited that you've joined us today for a conversation about the future of love. Now, since the pandemic has reshaped the way we have interacted over the past year and a half, it is indeed an honor to have some distinguished experts here with us stepping into the Global Columbia Collaboratory to draw on insights about how this has impacted the future of relationships and love. I'm looking forward to a robust discussion about this important topic. And now before we begin, and especially for those of you joining for the very first time today, I want to provide a bit of background about the Global Columbia Collaboratory. With the disruption caused by the COVID-19 pandemic, the Columbia University Center for Undergraduate Global Engagement, in partnership with Columbia Global Centers and Columbia World Projects, launched the Global Columbia Collaboratory as a virtual exchange initiative to support students around the world. The collaboratory brings students, thought leaders, and educators together, promotes cross-cultural communication, and enhances skills and global competence to allow students to reflect, ideate, and collaborate to empower them to make a difference in the world. Students have participated from over 25 different countries and are drawn from all three undergraduate schools at Columbia, representing over 30 majors. And we also have students participate from dual degree programs with Sciences Po in Paris and Trinity College Dublin. Using smartphones and laptops to access the collaboratory virtual exchange platform, students form a community of global thinkers and problem solvers through participation in themed global seminars featuring international speakers, such as our seminar today, as well as facilitated reflection, ideation, and collaboration activities. As learnings and perspectives are shared across the collaboratory, students are encouraged to collaborate to support the further development of ideas into projects that have the potential to address the most urgent challenges of our time. Students' project teams receive funding to tackle specific global issues and topics of interest, and their work is featured in our online gallery. We are thrilled that over 300 student participants have been actively engaged in the collaboratory since it launched in May of 2020, last summer. And we currently have a summer cohort of collaboratory students joining us live today from around the world. And this is the third seminar for the summer cohort. Welcome to all of you. Now, some of our students will ask questions to our panelists today, and I encourage the global audience to also submit questions through the Q&A button at the bottom of the screen. Again, I want to welcome everyone to this Global Columbia Collaboratory Seminar, and I want to thank all of our partners and our esteemed panelists. We are so pleased to be working directly with the Columbia Global Centers for these seminars. And at this time, I want to introduce Safwan Masri, Columbia University Executive Vice President for Global Centers and Global Development, who will introduce us to our panelists today. Safwan?
Thank you, Shannon. Thank you. I'm so glad to be with all of you for what promises to be a fascinating and hopefully helpful conversation about love and its prospects in this post-pandemic and highly digitized world. This is a very, very special webinar. We've been looking forward to it for a very long time. This past year was not rife with delightful images, but one did capture my attention. Perhaps many of you saw it as the story made news around the world. So let me share it. Early on in the pandemic, a young man alone in his apartment saw a woman dancing alone on a rooftop a block or two away in Brooklyn, New York. He was moved, intrigued, and he decided to get in touch. These bare bones of the story are timeless. I mean, think of David on the rooftop spying on Bathsheba. But this is a modern tale. And so what came next, thankfully, was not the king's men going over to bring the object back to their leader. Instead, our New Yorker sent a drone across with a note inviting her to text him. I just love that. Soon, dinner was arranged. On separate rooftops, waving across the expanse, they dined on whatever each found in the cupboards or in the fridge. This alfresco evening went well enough that a second date was planned, for which our Panglossian character showed up literally inside a plastic bubble. The news footage captures him appearing to roll down the city street in his transparent inflatable globe, clutching flowers, the laughing woman beside him. It was completely charming and instructive as well. Now, you don't have to be heterosexual, young, white, or even remotely interested in finding romance to be enlivened by this refusal to be cowed by all the necessary precautions and anxiety the pandemic engendered. His bubble had literal and symbolic power when you think about it. He followed every COVID protocol, right? While simultaneously bursting the bubble of isolation so many of us were trapped within. Now, I don't know, but I would be very interested to know if there is a relationship that has blossomed as a result of those early dates. Now, there's a way in which the pandemic exposed and exported the truth about American culture, turning loneliness into a global norm. About a generation ago, the political scientist Robert Putnam attributed the erosion of community in the US to the enormous decline in face-to-face interaction and a lack of social discourse. He theorized then that the main cause was technology, right? Which individualized our leisure time. But at that time, technology meant television and the newly invented internet, not streaming videos, texting, Facebook, Twitter, cell phone apps, dating websites, or drones. Yet Putnam foresaw the repercussions of a culture that replaced mingling and civic organizations with privatized entertainment. Loneliness, diminished trust, and increasing polarization. The pandemic, which forced us to rely only on technology to safely interact, amplified all of this, of course. The isolation that Putnam identified as an American phenomenon was now global. And globally, more than a third of the adult population currently reports feeling isolated and lonely. The numbers among young people in the United States are almost twice that. Imagine. The loneliest people in the world are those who are hyper-connected digitally. There is a correlation, perhaps. Mm-hmm. And here we are all gathered talking about love virtually. Right? This explains some of the power of that image, our man in the bubble. He used modern technology to enhance real life, to take a risk and send a drone over. When that worked, he used his cell phone to arrange parallel rooftop dining, a real world experience, even though they could not actually meet. It was not life as reflected in a screen or an interaction prodded into being by an algorithm or filter. It was unpredictable, born of impulse and happenstance, but it captured many of the themes we're exploring today, the evolving uses of technology, the effects of the pandemic, and romance, while remaining unexpected and perhaps counterintuitive. The future does not necessarily mean a more extreme version of the present, perhaps the acceleration of our shift into the digital world will prompt a reassessment rather than a further evolution towards a two-dimensional reality. And I have seen this in the few weeks I've been back in New York by coming back in touch with people that I had not seen in 14 months. As societies, we have become increasingly inclusive, redefining gender norms and accepting a breadth of sexual identities. Support for this progress has often been facilitated by social media, with online communities helping many people feel less marginalized. But translating this activity into life in the physical space we all inhabit to a shared ecosystem is necessary to shift people away from loneliness and towards lives replete with love and romance. How do we accomplish this? What can we learn from nature? And what do observations about our neurological response to the digital world tell us? Although it may seem out of context, I can't help but think about the various protests and demonstrations in support of Black Lives Matter, Asian lives, and Palestinian lives that we witnessed this year. The urge to get out and ally oneself with others overrode the fears of contagion. The need to be part of a movement in the real world with bodies on the line compelled people to come together in the streets and work towards change. This is not romance, but it most definitely is love. And that is the beginning of everything, is it not? Mm. Today, to help us answer our burning questions about love, I am so very pleased and honored to present two extraordinary panelists to our audience. Daniel Jones is the author of one of the most popular and widely read columns in the New York Times, Modern Love, since it began in 2004, and now manages the franchise, which has become two weekly columns, three books, Love Illuminated, Modern Love, and Tiny Love Stories, a weekly podcast with more than 120 million downloads, an Amazon TV series entering its second season, and the Modern Love Live events. Dr. Judy Kuriansky is a noted clinical psychologist, professor at Columbia University's Teachers College, author of The Complete Idiot's Guide to a Healthy Relationship, and The Complete Idiot's Guide to Dating, and a mental health advocate at the United Nations, to top it all. As the former host of the popular Love Phones radio call-in show and advice columnist, Judy has answered, or Dr. Judy, as you are referred to by your followers, has answered thousands of questions about love from people of all ages and all cultures. Welcome to you both, Judy and Daniel. And let's start our conversation. And if you don't mind, Daniel, I'd like to start with you. Since you will be with us, I should tell the audience, only for the first hour. And we are very, very grateful that you have been able to accommodate the schedule. Now, Daniel, you've read, I think, more than 9,000 love story submissions to the New York Times every year, right? You have done so for 17 years. So one can do the math. Let's start at the beginning. What was the impetus? You know, how did you get there? What was the impetus for the column? What kind of story submissions did you see at first? And then, you know, if you reflect back on those 17 years, was there a column that garnered the most reader responses? I remember you had, and I looked back at it not long ago, in 2014, you had sort of top 10 love stories in your column. You know, when you look back, is there a column or more that you still think about? And have you seen the stories change over the 17 years? So what got you to do this? And what's your reflection on it 17 years later?
Thank you, Safwan. That's so many questions to start with. let me just say first that introduction was fantastic. I love the way you pulled together that specific anecdote about the rooftops with the Black Lives Matter protests and the sense of technology and community and isolation. Those are all the pertinent issues today. And well done. I think Judy and I can step away now.
Are you kidding? I only scratched the surface. I'm putting it out there for you.
That was a PhD thesis.
Yeah, very, very nice. And set me up well. I first wanted to say, before I answer your question, we were fascinated by that anecdote about the in styles in the style section. We talked about that anecdote of the story of the guy who sends the drone over to the woman. And because we're in the news business a skeptical bunch, we were talking about it in terms of was the woman really the audience for this act, or was the internet the audience for this act? And was it truly romantic, or was it self-promotional? And I admit that's a less fun way of looking at it, but there's something worrisome about intimate acts becoming fodder for sort of the internet, for internet fame. That's an interesting angle to view romance through. And to view that story through, because he was very intentional about promoting it. Anyway, the column started basically because my wife and I were having trouble in our marriage, and we were both writers and editors and wanted to find out what was happening in you know, not even quite midlife marriage, early marriage with small children and work, and how you're expected to manage that all and succeed in every corner of it. And so my wife, Kathy Hanauer, decided to talk to other women who are in similar situations. And it led to a book of essays by women called The Bitch in the House. and it was so successful that it backed me into the corner of having to create a male response called The Bastard on the Couch, of what men felt in terms of their responsibilities and their expectations of marriage, where both people are working and trying to parent and trying to be married. The books, because they were by husband and wife, and because I think the content was very probing, got the attention of a lot of people, but the styles editor at the Times, who was then Trip Gabriel, decided he wanted that kind of content on a weekly basis in the New York Times in his section, and asked us as husband and wife if we would be interested in doing that. And so we started it that way. It didn't turn out to be a job for a couple. It was really a one-person job. And my wife was already off on a new project. So she left it in my lap. And I honestly thought it would be a year or two. And my boss told me to expect it to be a year or two. So the fact that it's still going on 17 years later and has become my life surprises me as much as anyone. But I think the staying power in part was an early decision to not solicit essays, to not solicit people's stories and meet with other editors and decide what a story was and then try to find a writer who could write that story. It was to open it up to everyone and commit to reading everything that came in and finding those sort of unusual stories and letting the readers and the public tell us what was important to them and what their stories were. And I think that's it, to the extent that it's remained fresh and a chronicle of our times, that's credit to that decision and the writers who sent their stories in. And I've just worked hard at it. And as much as I get worn down by the volume, it's counterbalanced by the joy of discovering, learning something new about love after all of this, you know, 140,000 stories that have crossed my desk or however many it is. It's really hard to raise my eyebrows and think, wow, that that's really moving or that's really new. But the fact that that just continues to happen on an almost weekly basis is testament to the variety and the staying power of love as a subject. And it's endlessly complicated. It's not, one cannot master it. no matter how much you study it or how much you live it, you cannot master it. It will surprise you and defeat you and refresh you. So that's what I find interesting about it. And I guess in terms of the column that that really sort of blew the doors down was an essay called "To Fall in Love with Anyone, Do This." And it was published, I believe, in 2015 and written by Mandy Len Catron. And it was an essay that that was about a psychological study that was in pursuit of the idea that could you facilitate people falling in love? Could you facilitate strangers falling in love by equalizing vulnerability? And you equalize vulnerability by having each person ask the other person these increasingly probing questions, 36 questions, it turned out, in sets of 12. And I think the thing that's so hard and has really perplexed people forever is, how do I be vulnerable when I'm not sure the other person will be? How do I admit I like someone or love someone? How do I admit my weaknesses if I'm not sure they will do so as well? No one wants to be exposed in that way. And a lot of relationships don't proceed because of that paralyzing fear. And this game, although it's much more serious than a game, equalized that. And it forced you to each answer the same questions and talk about your lives and get to know each other and be vulnerable. And it was just a masterpiece. And it was read and continues to be read by tens of millions of people around the world. Has led to, I don't even know how many relationships and marriages and children and on and on and on. But it was brilliant and completely a joy to be a part of.
Wow, I love that. So maybe we'll come back to that as a theme, because perhaps, you know, one of the elements of a good loving relationship is managing one's ego, right? And you manage your ego by exposing your vulnerabilities and seeking to equalize the vulnerabilities. I love that. So before I turn to Dr. Judy, I have to ask you, you're still married to your wife, and how has the, yes?
Am I? Yes.
Okay. So good to hear. And and so the writing was sort of a cathartic process that helped you mend the issues that you were having. I mean, it sort of allowed each of you to distance yourselves a little bit and reflect. And she writes her book, you write your book, and you know, you.
Yeah, I mean, we do best. We do best with. With space and overlap of work. And we do worst when we're most pushed out of each other's lives. And when we can find overlap in our work, we do best. So yeah, I mean, you know, like I said, I'm not a love guru in any sense. I don't do this any better than anybody else. But if anything, I'm more aware of my failings because I see it reflected in so much of what I read.
Yeah. Dr. Judy, so I'm going to ask you a similar question. How did you come into this? I mean, you started out as a research scientist at Columbia. You're at Teachers College, and then you got into the field of love, sex, relationships, both academically and out there in the public space. So tell us about your journey. You need to unmute.
You, first of all, I'm going to give you, Stefan, a honorary PhD for asking a very sensitive question to Daniel and very bold about, okay, how's your relationship now? What's making it work or not work? Good for you. Welcome, Stefan. Shannon, thank you. And good to hear your story, Daniel. So honestly, because honesty is a fundamental part of love. I know that from conducting so many surveys about love. Trust comes in first. So good for you. So thank you, Cephalon. In terms of how I got to the love issue, as you said, I when I was still in college, at Smith College, I started at Columbia, at Columbia Psychiatric Institute as a research scientist, and then became a senior research scientist comparing psychotic disorders of schizophrenics and depressed people in England, America. Okay, how did I get to sex and love? Well, my team got approached by Masters and Johnson. I mean, people know that because there was a TV series about them, the gurus, and asked to do evaluation of does a two-week program to make people's sex life better. And so that's how I got into this at a very young age. And then I went on TV to answer questions about whether or not toothbrush makes you more kissable from a scientific point of view. And they hired me to be a reporter on WCBS TV. And so I was doing stories about psychology things. And then I moved to WABC. And then I got asked to do a radio show because I was in actually I was also playing music. I was in a rock band of all women at that time. It was a big thing. And so the program director asked me, well, can you do this radio show 5 nights a week, 3 hours a night? Okay, Dr. Ruth was on the radio 15 minutes on another station and answer people's questions about love and sex. I said, well, I'd never been on a radio. And he said, well, if you've been in a band, you know what makes an interesting story. Talk about stories, Daniel, right? And so I started that in 1980, and wow, that lasted a long time on WABC and then WOR and then Z100 with a lot of young people. So I've heard, like you said, thousands of questions, and I did on TV and for newspapers all over the world, the Singapore Straits Times and the South China Morning Post and everything. So that was like immersion into Dr. Judy, my boyfriend left me. What do I do? Dr. Judy, my husband is flirting with my best friend. What do? I dump him? You know, and all these questions, that thousands and thousands of questions. And people said to me, don't you get bored and of all the same questions? Years, you've been doing this 3 nights a week, 5 nights a week, 3 hours a night, 5 hours a week. And I said, no, because each person is a beautiful kernel of their life. And if you just connect with them on this energetic spiritual level to try to find the place that they can make life better, that would be great. Of course, I do have to say, Cephalon, since it was a lot of young people, they used to call and joke. Like they call, you know, and they go to their friends the next day and they'd say, I was on the phones and I asked a question. I said, I like to sleep with my guitar next to me in bed. Am I sick? Will any girl ever want me? You know? And then, you know, they'd be the king of school. So that was years and years of that I put in Generation Sex. The America's hottest sex therapist asked the hottest questions about sex. So that happened. And then I got asked by, I had a professional hat, like you said, Cephalon. You know, I was still doing academia, writing books about the Middle East and about eco-psychology and disaster. And I was going all over the world doing disaster recovery in China and Japan and St. Martin and the tsunami, everywhere. And so I had that going and the music going and all that thing going as a tapestry of life and the love for myself. And then I got asked out of the blue, I got a call from somebody in psychology and said, Dr. Judy, do you want to represent us at the United Nations? I said, I don't know. I've never been to the United Nations. But my father taught me always say yes. So I said yes. And that led to now 18 years of negotiating about mental health and well-being at the United Nations with lots of ambassadors and countries all over the world, and learning how love can be infused and is infused into diplomacy, that it's important for that, and even resolutions about love that, guess what country put forth at the UN? Take a guess, what country added the culture of peace with love and conscience as a resolution at the United Nations?
I want to say it's an Asian country.
Well, you know what? It would have been an Asian country, because you're right. We can get into talking about that, because Asia is, you know, one of my favorites in terms of, you know,
and which country is it? Is it
but it's actually an Arab country.
Really? The United Arab Emirates?
Well, you're right in another way. Oh, you preempted me. I'm going to get to that in a second. Very good. You see, I told you you're going to get a PhD. I'm giving you a PhD honorary at Columbia, if they let me. Bahrain.
Bahrain, really?
Yes. Bahrain.
Fascinating.
And very interesting for everybody to know. We need to have you have one in Amman, in Jordan.
Right.
You need to have one in Bahrain, because they are actually known for interreligious relationships, which is a part of love, loving everybody, not just one-on-one, but loving all cultures. But this is Bahrain, who introduced this resolution about the culture of peace with love and conscience.
And love being inclusive, gay love included?
Love included. Love inclusive. Oh, well, I know. Well, yeah. we work on those things, really, yeah. At the UN. The International Peace Institute is working on those issues about inclusive love. So we're getting there.
All the more power to you. No, the reason I guessed, United Arab Emirates, and I think it's Bhutan. I'm not sure, but they have a cabinet ministry of happiness. So that's why I thought love.
You are right. Bhutan, I'll say this really quickly, because Daniel, we need to hear from him, because he has the answer. So in a nutshell, you absolutely right. 1972, Bhutan's king came up with global national happiness that he was measured instead of GDP. And that was how many people do you have in your life who support you, who love you, who care for you? And they were doing that at the UN from 2012. Then they sort of dropped it. They had change in government. And you are so right, Safwan. UAE picked it up. They had the first minister of happiness. And I've been to all their meetings at the World Government Summit. So you're right.
So, Daniel, let's... so many thoughts going through my mind, but when we talk about love, right? I mean, we tend to focus, and in this webinar and what you do and Dr. Judy does, is very focused on romantic love, right? And oftentimes we think, you know, love comes from different corners, different channels. So some people feel, and this is a question actually from somebody who's in our audience today, who said, can one get over the feeling of being loveless? And I'm assuming that this person's question is related to romantic love. And I'm not exactly sure. Help me understand the question and answer it.
Yeah, that's a hard question.
When you're thrown a question like that, what do you make of it?
Well, I wonder if it's coming from trends of people living, more people than ever living alone, marriage rates declining, and new ways of forming relationships becoming more acceptable, and whether that's gay marriage or open relationships that I think lead people to think, what am I looking for? I think the options used to be narrower, and I think it's, you know, people feel more free to figure out who they are and what they want. I don't know if that has led to greater isolation in a way. I'm not a social scientist in that way. I do see that that the technology piece, you know, there's an overwhelming, I mean, I see the search for love, the endless search for love, and the desire to be with another person. And I do think we are hardwired to connect with other people. You know, that is what we're here to do, to connect with other people in whatever way. And I think there are obstacles, there are increasing obstacles to that with technology, where it at once, you know, the promise of technology is we're going to give you shortcuts to things. We're going to make it easier to connect. It's going to be a shortcut to love. And so I think there's a lot of frustration when that doesn't turn out to be true. And sometimes technology seems to be an obstacle. And what the pandemic, I mean, the pandemic was a horrible thing, but it's also this sort of once in a lifetime opportunity to see, to have the world shaken up and see how people respond to it. And I was fascinated to see how inventive human beings are to immediately begin to connect in other ways. And, you know, technology was the way to do that, to go on dates that were virtual dates, to have FaceTime calls that turned into phone sex, that, you know, it sort of like go through all the stages of the relationship without ever physically being with another person. Because they couldn't be. And we were heading in that direction anyway, but the pandemic has accelerated it in such a dramatic way. And when we talk about the future of love, like my question is, is there a future of love that's only virtual? Because I think people did find comfort and satisfaction, and they said goodbye to loved ones in the hospital virtually. Like these things were insufficient, but they were also something. And I love that question of like, what is sustenance for a human soul, you know, and how do you achieve that, and how much of that can be virtual forever and be satisfying? I don't know, that's where I think we're headed in some ways.
Yeah, it's amazing how much we've learned to channel love in different ways while we were separated. You know, I am personally a hugger. You know, I physical contact is very important to me. And I found that, you know, whether it's on FaceTime or on Zoom, I relied more, even though it's difficult to detect, but, you know, the way I looked at a person, the way I expressed love with my eyes became far more important. But staying with the theme of sort of lovelessness, if you will, you know, the question from the audience participant. So I think, I mean, at the risk of oversimplification, I think of people, including myself, sort of as falling into one of two categories: those who cannot live without having romantic love in their lives, and by the way, a colleague of mine, who I'm not going to disclose who it is, because she'll never talk to me again, this was her idea to do this this webinar. And I've observed over the years that she sort of has to have romantic love in her life. And I know other people who are like that. And then there are those who feel like, I can live without having romantic love in my life. I prefer to have love come from other kinds of engagements. You know, I get fulfilled. And, you know, sex is the easy part. Love is the hard part. And, you know, I don't want the headache of love. What do you say to that, Daniel?
I think... people are getting creative about getting their needs met. And those needs can be romance, they can be sex, they can be family. But I think lovelessness is an interesting term. I think people seek love in their lives. Love is hope, you know, love is connection and hope. But how they find those pieces and put them together, I think contemporary marriage there's a big burden on contemporary marriage as serving too many needs, and we live too long. Let's face it, you know, we didn't used to live this long, but we live a really long time. Marriages can last a really long time, and they're supposed to be our best friend and our lover and people who share responsibilities and meals and parenthood, taking care of their parents. There's so many burdens on a marriage. And I think a lot of marriages become very just sort of practical units. And sometimes people get starved of their marriage becomes more of a friendship, and that can sustain it. But then they aren't getting other needs met. I don't know. I think it's a real conundrum as to how we're supposed to navigate lives together over the long haul. And some people do sort of bust out of the rules. We published, actually, the Modern Love podcast that's coming out tomorrow is about two open marriages. And I talked to the one couple where the guy had written the essay. And it was so fascinating to hear them talk about it. And it was there, they had sort of come to, they were in therapy with a mediator to divorce. And the mediator said, well, maybe you should try opening your relationship. And they were both sort of shocked and appalled and came around to it. And now some 15 years later, they've been married for 29 years and are going strong and expect to be together forever. But getting over that hurdle of changing the rules that they had agreed to was enormous. You know, it's hard to get all your needs met. And the complication of love and long-term relationships is you have to negotiate it with another person. Mm. And they might not be on the same page as you.
Do you think it's more difficult to establish that and open up the relationship and be able to get that hurdle? This is a tough question, so feel free to say, you know, do you think it is more difficult between a heterosexual couple than not? In other words, is there perhaps a sort of a yeah, let me just leave it at that.
Well, in this case, the man is bisexual, and that was part of what led them to this impasse. But, you know, I'll go back to something Dr. Judy said early on was trust and honesty. And I think these kinds of relationships need trust and honesty more than anything. And you're not going to avoid jealousy, and you're not going to avoid having your feelings hurt. But if you can be honest and trust each other and come up with a set of sort of boundaries and rules, it can be navigated. You're really overcoming the main hurdles that they described were overcoming others' judgments and family expectations and a sense that they were doing something wrong that was not what was socially approved. That's what they said was the main hurdle. They got over those hurdles and they're happier for it.
Terrific. Dr. Judy, have, you know, over the years, because you've been doing this for a while, right? And, you know, you were a media psychologist of sorts, you have been. The questions that you get, you know, both from single people as well as from couples, what do people want to know, do you find? And do you find that that has changed over the years and over the decades? You know, is there an intergenerational shift, especially in a world where we live today, where there is gender fluidity, sexual fluidity, but you know, even outside of that, even though that is being mainstream, but sort of in the historical mainstream, what do people seek in terms of advice, and how has that changed?
Well, Stefan, some of the questions are absolutely perennial. After all the years and thousands of questions all over the world, by the way, yeah. Single people want to know, where do I go to meet the one? And is there one? And people who are together, however, whether married or not, want to know, how do we keep the flames alive? As Daniel was just honestly talking about, how do we keep the sex alive, the intimacy going? And my answer to how to keep the intimacy going, which we could explore a great deal, is basically to go back to dating. When you were dating, You were just in limerence, as we call it, excited, feeling erotic towards a person, wanting to find out what's your favorite color, what did you enjoy most, where do you like to go, who's your favorite sport, all these things. And then we forget and take the person for granted. So that is the key to keeping the intimacy alive, keeping seeing the person as new and fresh. And keeping the sex alive has so much to do with also finding out new things, asking your partner just simply, what can I do to please you? Mm. Just that. And then doing it. There are, in fact, four T's to what is, I consider, the intimate relationship, since you talked about that you're a hugger, Safwan. I love that. So that's one of my T's, which is touch, talk, time, and trust, which Daniel agreed to. So trust is fundamental. Time people have had during the pandemic, sometimes too much time, okay? But having time and spending time together, I say for couples all the time, you have to even write it in your book of two times a week for an hour that you're gonna spend just you, no kids, no nothing, no phones, whatever. And then talking, because now, you know, people have been like this, okay? They're covered up. They haven't really been talking. They can't barely hear each other. And they're doing this on the phone all the time with little tweets for, you know, a few 240 characters, which is barely enough to really do the Shakespearean love story. And the last one is really about touching. And Safwan, that's what you were saying, the hugging is missing. And that is very important, because hugging, it is a chemical reaction besides a comforting and psychological reaction. There's been so much research about people petting doggies, and therefore their blood pressure goes down for older people and autistic kids and anybody. And so much research about monkeys that show monkeys are attracted to the soft mother rather than the wire mother that gives them food even. Mm. We need contact comfort. So basically, in terms of what Daniel was mentioning before and what you asked him, love has to do with loving yourself first. I have, how many times of years and years I've gone to like teaching people, you have to love yourself before you can love anybody else. So, okay, everybody right now, hug yourself.
I'm gonna do it.
Oh, really? And feel what that feels like.
No, that is so important, and we forget that. I mean, so to go back to the column that Daniel referred to, equalizing vulnerabilities, right? I mean, first be in touch, be aware, be self-aware, be in touch with your own vulnerabilities in order to be able to be open to other people and become empathetic towards them, towards their vulnerabilities, no question. Shannon, I know that you have a question that's on video from one of our collaborative students. You wanna bring it on now?
Yes, excited to share these questions. So our first question is a video, and here we go.
Hello, my name is Eleanor Campbell. I'm a rising second year in Columbia College, and I plan to study economics. My question for the Future of Love seminar is, how do we differentiate modern love from prior expressions of love? And how do we see that differentiation playing out in the future?
Mm. Oh, Daniel, I don't know if you want to try to take a stab at this.
Sure. I mean, I think we celebrate romantic love and marry for romantic love in a way that we didn't before. Marriage used to be more about religion and class and practicality. And now everything is about love, which makes me feel a little sorry for love sometimes. Like I feel like love, there's too much pressure on love as what's binding us together. I think that's one of the main differences, is that that love has become central as the, you know, uniting thing between a couple or people, and I think what worries me, I guess, in the stories that I receive, is that it's elevated to the point where there's a lot of fantasy about what romantic love promises and what lasting love is. And even, you know, Dr. Judy talking earlier about the one person, that there is one person out there that you're meant to be with. I think the problem with fantasy is that it then leads to disappointment. And we celebrate the beginning of love. We celebrate the wedding as the high point of achievement. You know, it's not that hard to get married and to ask someone to marry you and then to have the wedding. It costs your parents a lot of money, but otherwise it's pretty easy to do. And that's what we're celebrating. Like, I think you can only go down from there in a way. So the sort of fantasies involved with love, which I think technology exacerbates, because we are meeting people. Well, here's an enormous difference between what used to be and what is now. We date mostly strangers now. And I think we're so used to that within the last 20 years that it's become second nature. We don't even question it, but that didn't used to happen. We didn't used to date strangers. We used to date people we knew, people our family knew, and people who were in our community. We didn't have to hide things about ourselves because everyone knew who we were. And they knew that this was the person with MS, and this was the person with a prosthetic leg, and whatever. There weren't these insecurities about packaging ourselves and trying to create who we are. That's what technology has wrought. And when you only get a piece of someone, you fantasize the rest of them. And if you're falling for that person, you fantasize on the positive side. And then you meet them in person, and it's hard to live up to that. So I worry about, my main worry about contemporary love is the little pieces we get of people and how we fantasize to fill in the rest and how that can lead to disappointment. And I just see that happening again and again and again.
Yeah, there's a follow-up question that's related. I'll ask it now. And this was from Shariah Shatali. And it really relates to this finding love and technology and wondering in today's world where you can find anything from your phone, does love find you or do you actively need to find love yourself at this point?
Question. Is that for me?
Yes, yes.
We're all either, yeah. Yeah,
both. Either of you.
Yeah.
I'm fascinated by the working for love. Like people, like when people say finding love is a job, you have to make it a job, you know? And, the problem now, is volume. And when you open up your phone to have limitless possibilities, we have to come up with systems that reduce the volume or you can't deal with it. And what are those systems? Well, they're tribal, you know, they're okay. I want someone around my age, or I want someone who's exactly 8 to 10 years younger than me. I want someone who's white, or I want someone who's black, or I want someone who's Jewish. And almost by default, we succumb to these tribal instincts of, I guess I want someone who's like me, or I guess I want someone who's like this, and that would make me happy. We're guessing about our own happiness, and I think we're very bad at predicting our own happiness. I think the more successful dating apps are ones that work through networks of friends and people that we have in common and rely on that sort of affinity, where those would have been people you would have met in person at a party or through school or through work. They would have been people that maybe you would hit it off with. And those just as an observer, I think those seem to be the most successful. But there's just, you know, there's so much to navigate with finding love these days, and so much in our heads about who would be good for me. And when you're out with someone, I love the essays that the people who are out with someone, but they can almost feel their phone burning in their pocket with other choices. You know? They're finding it hard to even listen to that person talk because they're thinking about the people in their pocket who they could go out with. either tomorrow or maybe later tonight, you know?
It's like shopping.
It is. Yeah. And it works. I mean, it works often. It works really often, but it's an interesting.
Dr. Judy, what do you think?
I'll answer that on two levels. That was a lot of levels of question. So first of all, I think for romance, I think it's important to go back to the old days of romance as opposed to everything that's technological now. For as an example, a woman who said to me, I am totally in love with this man I met because he is pulling my chair out. Can you imagine? Who does that now? Okay, that's that. I totally agree, secondly, with what Daniel said about friends, in your friend circle, as opposed to opening yourself up to that swiping all the time that's going on, which is very hurtful for people. Third of all, I want to say, also in terms of what the video, that brilliant video that we saw at the beginning of all these stories that were culled from movies, we relate to love, as Daniel was even saying, on reaction to our, what we call in psychology, love scripts. Who are the people in life, in stories, in movies, who most we want to copy? Is our love life like Richard Burton and Elizabeth Taylor, you know, screaming at each other all the time? Is it like Brangelina, Brad Pitt and Angelina, you know, fighting? Or is it like Jay-Z and Beyoncé? Who are these characters that we repeat? And if they're not characters from a film or modern culture, what story have we learned from our youth that we are looking for to repeat? And last thing I wanted to say, which was referred to by Daniel and by you, Safwan, and also Shannon in the question that the young girl asked, is in relation to who do we really get attracted to? Because I must say it is also true that birds of a feather flock together and we do look for people who are like us, but it is also true that opposites attract. They can conflict, but if you work together and compromise, it can work out. So there, that's the generalization, and it's not like one main rule.
Wow. You're defying all my preconceived notions, because here, you know, you're looking at somebody who's never, ever once used an app, right? And I'm always proud of saying, I don't date. I just fall in love head over heels, right? So in a way, love finds me, and then it becomes, I think I'm one of those people also. Why am I talking about myself? We should talk privately afterwards, okay?
Yeah, I need a session with Judy.
Yeah, but Daniel, I know you have to go in a couple of minutes. And again, we're very, very grateful to having you with us as long as we have. You know, maybe if you can, just any thoughts that you want to share, but also the question that I had asked Dr. Judy earlier, and that is, what have you seen that, you know, reflects sort of the changes, societal changes, when it comes to identity, gender identity, and fluidity today, and how have you had to adapt and evolve with the times? Because many of these things are pretty recent trends. I mean, you know, we've observed them over the past decade, not over the past few decades. So how does that factor into the work that you do?
Yeah, well, I think the pace at which gay marriage became legal in states and then nationally was so dramatic and so fast, and happened within the life of the modern love column completely. And it opened the door for, I believe, for discussions about gender and transgender to become, for those stories to be told. And I could see this in what we received. In the first few years, we didn't receive a single story from a transgender writer that I recall. And we're talking about thousands of stories. And that to me says that people did not feel safe telling that story publicly. So I'm really heartened by the fact that people see social change, see sort of social acceptability changing, and then feel like they can tell their story. And telling individual stories is crucial. People react out of fear for things they don't understand, and they don't understand them at an abstract level. But when they hear it from a person, this is what I'm going through, or from a partner of a person, they can empathize and they understand, and they think those are emotions I've felt too. That's a loss that I've felt too. And I think that's the path to social change on an individual level. I mean, there's the political level and sort of mass movements, but to change individual minds, I think it's through empathy and storytelling. I feel like it's the responsibility of the column, being in a newspaper especially, to chronicle that change and to represent those voices.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you for doing that. Thank you for all the work that you do, Daniel. And it is so instructive and inspiring to hear you talk, because, you know, you talk about love, you talk about life, you talk about humanity, and really, really inspired by having met you. And I'm sure I speak for all of our audience members when I say we're incredibly, incredibly grateful. And thank you for opening up, also for opening up. and I love the story how you got into it. So thank you, Daniel.
And thank you, Safwan. Yeah. Thank you, Judy. And thank you, Shannon. I really enjoyed it.
Look forward to seeing you in person, I hope.
Yes. Okay. We can hug.
Yes.
For sure. That was wonderful. I'd like to pick up on what the question that you asked, if you don't mind, Daniel. Please. Is that okay?
Yeah, absolutely. And then I have a couple of other questions for you, and then a student question, and then we're going to turn to the audience questions.
Okay, great.
Within the next half an hour.
Right. So I've seen the arc of this fluid, as you called it, sexuality over so many decades now, really starting in 1973 when I was on the committee for the book that made the diagnosis, the Diagnostic and Statistical Manual, when they were first debating about homosexuality. And we were talking about how, wait a second, we have to change this whole thing, open it up. Then coming later in 1980, in the early 80s, I was writing a book that was about the questions that people asked me on the radio. And I had a chapter in there about gay relationships and HIV AIDS. And I said, this is a very important issue. We have to, you know, put this in the book. And the editor, who was gay, by the way, said, oh no, you know, that's too hot to handle. And then the same thing when I was on TV and on a channel, and I wanted it, we were doing a special about HIV, and I wanted to talk about that from the psychological angle. So I'm just saying, in the 80s, this was such a tight, you know, restricted issue. And now I've seen it change, fortunately, so much so that we don't just talk about, when I did Generation Sex, there was a huge chapter, which was boys who love girls, who love boys, who love girls, who love girls, who love boys, who love, you know, I just went on and on and on. So this was already starting a long time ago, thank goodness. And now what's really happened is that the LGBTQ, we need to not stop there, because it's I, intersex, and it's A, and then it's A, which is really important, which is the allies. Because years ago we used to grade people A, B, C, D if they accepted their partner. So that A at the end is really major. And now what we have, my partner, my co-host on my radio show, used to call himself trisexual, which meant he would try anything. And now we have the big word, which is non-binary. And when you have celebrities who, you know, for better or worse, become like models of things, like Demi Lovato coming out and saying that I'm non-binary, it really affirms a lot of young people and older people's feelings that I'm okay, because my basic message to everybody of every age, no matter what issue they're talking about, their gender, their sexuality, their love, their whatever, is first of all, start with three things that I learned from thousands of radio calls. One, that you are normal and you are okay for how you feel and accept those. Mm. Second of all, you're not the only one. That makes people feel so much better. Right. And third, if you want to talk to somebody, please do, because research shows that sharing and talking, which is actually, Saffron, what you mentioned earlier, talking about things to people really makes you feel better, yeah, and not isolated.
Right, right, right. No, and I think, you know, so much of this, the non-binary and all of it is, I define my individuality. You know, my identity is something that is organic to me. Do not label me or pigeonhole me or tell me what I am and classify me and treat me according to the way that you understand norms apply to that classification. So I think it's liberating. I think it, yeah, is, it is freedom. So let me end my portion of the questions with sort of an overarching and somewhat scientific, somewhat philosophical question. And that is, what can you tell us, because you know, you're a scientist first and foremost, right? About the science of evolution and genetics, okay? What do we know from it about love? You know, about love sort of as something that is hardwired in us, as something that is culturally and perhaps temporally impacted. You know, does it, does the concept of love evolve? You know, if is it a primal feeling that one has instinctively? So please.
The primal basic feeling is for reproduction, and that's the basic, and that then that continues. The rest of the answer to that very academic and interesting question has to do with different levels. Anthropologically, there are anthropologists like Margaret Mead who say relationships last for 4 years for that reproductive period and explains why older men go for younger women because of the propagation theory about that. Mm. We don't like that because we like to think in our Western world that relationships can last. But there are many who say that you have to work at that because we can love many people. The third element to your question is cultural. There are cultures who accept things, and then you have Italian cultures and the Romance religions where, and cultures where, you know, things are much open versus you live in a rural place, then you can either have many, a man can have many wives as they do in Africa, or you have your colonel central family. So these are cultural issues. And so all these elements come into it. And then the last one that I want to mention besides what we've talked about before is that there are chemical issues here, that different chemicals flow in the body related to the different stages of relationships. So you have things like phenylalanine that flow in the body at the initial stages, then you have cortisol, which interrupts if you're anxious, and then it interrupts the love cycle. And then you have endorphins that flow in the attachment phase when you really feel that strength of attachment to someone. People know those are endorphins because if you're a runner and you hit the wall, you know when you get flooded with that endorphins, and when you fall in love, you know that flood of endorphins. So there are all these chemical issues, cultural issues, biological issues, issues with our psychology and our background. What we've seen our parents do that we decide, I'm going to repeat that because they had a loving relationship like mine did, or, you know, that was awful. I don't want to have that. And you do something else.
Yeah. So, you know what? I lied. I have one other question because you just triggered me also when you talked about the various cultural things. So, you know, arranged marriages, right? I mean, that's a phenomenon that continues to exist in many conservative societies around the world, religious societies and so on. And in a way, it's like speed dating or you know, right? Except it's more uncertain because in arranged marriages, oftentimes you don't meet your future partner for life until the night of the wedding. And, you know, oftentimes those arranged marriages work and work very well. And love grows, right, as a result of that. What do you think makes for that? I mean, does love grow? Can you start a relationship with not even knowing the other person, let alone, you know anything about them, let alone equalize your vulnerabilities, as Daniel was saying. How does love grow?
Yes, well, there's a TV show on now about how they put people together and all of a sudden they see how they are. And you're right, arranged marriages that still happen in many countries can work. You know, here's my answer to that in simple words. Our relationship can work if you want it to work. Mm. If you're committed to make it work, that's it. You have to want to make it work. And then when I say work, I mean that sometimes it just flows, like you say, if you do have some magic connection and an energetic connection, which is a very important word here. Otherwise, you do have to sit down every now and then, like the exercises that I have in the Idiot's Guide to a Healthy Relationship, where you say, okay, do we have to make compromises here? What do we have to compromise about? We have to sit down and we have to talk. We have to put it on our schedule. So it's both. It can flow if it's right, and then you have to work at it. This is why when you mentioned earlier, Stefan, about Asia, okay? I love the Asian culture because they have so many gods and goddesses, okay? I'm surrounded by them. Here's Kuan Yin from China. All the Beijing parts of global Columbia centers, you know, will know the love character here. These are all the Buddhist and Sanskrit love goddesses and the gods and goddesses that I'm surrounded by these. These are just all over my house with the yin and the yang and energy. So in terms of your two bubbles that you mentioned, I love that story, going back to your bubbles, the two people in the bubbles on the rooftops, okay? They may not be touching like you like, but we can send energy through the internet right now, through across, people asked about long distance relationships, across states and countries, through our concentration, through our energy, by just sending love energy. Mm. And to a certain extent, this internet that we have here, we are having eye contact. That, Stefan, you even said you like eye contact. We have better eye contact here than we do when I'm sitting in my class or I'm at the UN and people are far away. We are really connected to each other in a different way. I don't care that the computer is between us. I feel connected to you.
And I do to you, and I send you love energy. and to you too, Shannon. And with this, I'm gonna turn it over to you, Shannon, to ask the questions and then from the audience.
Yeah, so Dr. Judy, we have another question from our students, and our students are very familiar with your mental health work with United Nations. And so this question from Noelle Files is along those lines. She is a 2023 class graduate from General Studies from Houston, Texas. And the question is, how has COVID, since it's disproportionately impacted the health and well-being of women, and in particular in the context of working mothers and other types of women caregivers, how has this had an impact on the relationships of women, especially women who may not have been able to access mental health resources, support groups, things of that nature? Very curious to hear your perspective on that.
I think that question is getting towards something that's very relevant at the UN, one angle of it, and that has to do with the shadow pandemic, as it's called. The UN Secretary General has called this out a great deal, and so has the woman, Amina Mohammed, who is the deputy. And that is the shadow pandemic, that during these times, violence has increased. We've been talking about happy things, but I do have to admit that people are angry. People are frustrated and irritated. And so they become either angry in their relationships, Shannon, you know, in a personal way, or even acting out on that to domestic violence. And there has been an increase reported everywhere in statistics about the increase in violence against women and girls, even to the point of, you know, trafficking of girls, etc. So this shadow pandemic, the UN women, all the organizations at the United Nations are paying attention to this. And on every level, people do. And even young activists. I have students who are young activists against this kind of violence against women, not just during the pandemic, as we call it the shadow pandemic, but at any time. So I think addressing that is one of the post-traumatic growth issues, because earlier we were talking about all the stress and symptoms and isolation. We call that post-traumatic stress, but I'm focusing now a great deal on the post-traumatic growth. Even Daniel mentioned something about that. There is a silver lining to this terrible pandemic, terrible, terrible things that have happened. And that is people have spent more time with family, and it has worked out. They've spent more time with friends, with grandchildren. They have learned how to do things like cooking. They have learned how to learned a new language. They have just learned and come in contact with themselves.
Exactly, more time with themselves, yeah.
Yes, and you know, I appreciate your comments, because there is quite a bit of work out there now that's pointing to the fact that all the gains we made with regard to gender equality and social inclusion may really have been impacted through the pandemic. The fact that things are regressing and we really need to really focus and push hard with regard to sustainable development goals relating to gender equality as a result of what has regressed during the pandemic.
Exactly. And right now, actually, Mexico and France have been hosting what's called the Equality Forum. And it is this weekend, actually, in Paris, and it's been going on. And the campaign goes on, you know, indefinitely about the support for women. And goal number five, as you mentioned in the UN Agenda for Sustainable Development, is gender equality and the empowerment of women and girls. And yeah, that is extremely important. I did a camp in Africa that taught girls self-esteem and learning a trade, whether it was, you know, hair weaving or selling vegetables to make money so they don't fall into transactional sex, which is having sex for money.
So I have a related question that actually has come from the general audience, and it's from Catherine White. And the theme relates to loss, love, grief, and death. And wanting to know, Catherine is a recent graduate of the School of Social Work and a former intern with the Center for Complicated Grief. And she wants to know if you can touch on love and attachment in relation to love, loss, and grief, and death, and how people have been able to cope and navigate love loss with remote interaction.
This has been more difficult, as we all know. And for those of us, including myself, who have lost family and loved ones during the pandemic and haven't been able to go to a funeral, we've had to do it, online. Actually, again, we have to look at it in terms of, first of all, there are the stages of grief and love. Everybody goes through them no matter what, in terms of the loss and then the denial and the anger and the depression and finally the acceptance. But I think that the one thing we have to look at, what can we gain from this that we have had this distance? And I think it is that we actually can create a kind of connection to people and family members that we didn't really have a connection to before because of this, because of reaching out. I can even say that personally. I became closer to some of my family members who I hadn't seen in ages because we had to have the funeral online and I got to see them. They were all over the country. So we must look at, yes, the grief is awful. How can we turn it around to post-traumatic growth, looking at the silver lining, learning about resilience, that we bounce back? You know, I have this ball always on my desk that we sink down to horrors, but we can bounce back up longer. This is what the UN even talks about in terms of building back better.
Absolutely. Thank you for pointing that out.
I'm sorry that for all those who have gone through these terrible.
Yeah. One more question that it's somewhat related, and you know, these are heavy issues, so we appreciate you just being candid in the time and attention. This is from an anonymous attendee who's talking about how they're still processing a relationship that ended recently, and they have a broad question about loving someone who's in recovery from substance abuse. He's been sober for 6 years, but I think in his mind, the proverbial airplane is still going down and he needed to secure his oxygen mask before he can attend to anything else. But in my mind, the plane wasn't going down at all. An insight you can provide on sort of how to really deal with that. I think this particular participant is eager to hear your perspective.
Right. Well, you know, that those issues have escalated also during the pandemic. Unfortunately, people have sought refuge in alcoholism and drug use, sadly. And so for those who are the partners, I think there really are two things. One is to find that unconditional love, the heart of that person with that you do love and that they are struggling. And for this person's person, they are in recovery, so that's good. And the other is a very practical issue that over years I've realized, and that is that you can, in order to stop falling into enabling the person in some way, and becoming addicted to them yourself, and putting up with some of the negativity, you really need support. The 12-step programs that were, you know, controversial in some way and years ago, they are really critical because you cannot go that road or that flight, since you're using the airplane, alone. That you really do have to have the person have a support system. And even though those meetings happen in person, they're happening online anyway and can create this kind of intimacy.
Shannon, do you have any more questions or do you want me to?
I think maybe you should probably go back to some of the questions you have, and I'll continue to curate the Q&A.
You know, there's so many directions, so many things that we haven't yet had a chance to cover, but I'm really intrigued in your work with the UN, right? Which is, you know, a political organization after all. And I loved what you said about Bahrain putting on the table a resolution around love and so on. How confident are you that change can happen as a result of the work that's taking place within the UN? I mean, how does it, I don't want to say how does it reconcile issues like this, because, you know, it's not a matter of reconciliation, it's part and parcel. You talk about sustainable development goals, you know, I mean, if you don't deal with love and inclusion, then what do we have to fix politically in the world? So I'd love to hear a little bit more.
Well, I think we are making such incredible strides lately that I'm just so thrilled. First of all, we have the Secretary General, that is the boss of the whole thing, who came out with a policy about mental health and well-being. Well, that was amazing. He talks specifically about what I've been saying, the silver lining. Let's turn this around and make this pandemic work for us through multilateralism, meaning all countries working together. So that's really critical. And then we have two countries I'd like to mention who are in the Security Council. You know, there are 5 permanent members and 10 rotating members. And so 2 of the rotating members, 1 is Ireland. What are the words that they are using? They're bringing into the Security Council words like they ran on empathy, that they're a country, Ireland, who understands conflict in the world. And so they were voted in. Empathy and resilience of all the problems that they have had with poverty and with conflict, religious conflict. And then we have Mexico, our neighbor to the south here from the United States, and they are bringing mental health into discussions in the Security Council. That is astounding. And on a recent event that I had for this, the Commission on the Status of Women, about the Israeli-Palestinian issue, always from a psychological point of view about what's in common. How can we bring people together knowing that they have common desires for love, for their family, for their children? Then also that issue is being looked at through in this lens.
Yeah. That's great. That's really, really encouraging and hopeful. I'm going to take a question from the audience. Ximena Pizarro asks about the disposability, that's the word that she uses, when you rely so much on date apps, right? And Ximena is saying, you know, I mean, online dating did allow us to connect with people beyond our immediate circles. But then there is, you know, a lot of times, you know, you find a match, you go on a date or two, and you don't like something about the person, and you go back to the infinite catalog of people to swipe away, right? It gives rise to the idea of disposable love, and it can be very discouraging, right? So the question is, what advice would you have to maintain resilience into persistence, perhaps, or patience, or indulgence in trying to know someone and not move on so quickly?
this is the reality of swiping that I really detest and really feel my heart goes out to people who are just swiped like crazy. This is a rejection of the deepest level. And I have to say, you know, to those people that you really must rely on certain truths, that ones that, you know, a mother might have said, which is, okay, next, best that ended because something better is coming. The door closes, the window opens. Remember that person lost you. They lost out on a possibility of knowing who you are, and there will be someone who appreciates you. Those are the ways to deal with that kind of brutal rejection.
Yeah. There's a question from Nur Shteye about polygamy, not necessarily in the context of marriage, but, you know, having non-monogamous relationships. Any ideas or thoughts about that, how that falls in the structure of modern love? Daniel talked about the one couple where the man, it's a man-woman couple, you know, he's bisexual, and they, through their therapist, came to the conclusion to have an open relationship. What are your thoughts on how having multiple sexual partners falls within the structure of modern love?
This started, you know, since days immemorial, really, when it was even structured, as I mentioned, in, you know, different cultures where it is okay. In Western cultures, where it's not considered socially acceptable, I think it's up to couples to make up their minds what they want to do and to be sure that they are not personally hurt, because this is what really ends up happening, that somebody gets hurt in some way that really destroys their love and their confidence in themselves. And other than that, I don't think we can pass judgment on that. There's a whole group of people and a whole wave of love for all, and living together in the modern ways of communes that we had in the 70s. And if it works for people, and then this, the key is making agreements and having everybody on board with those agreements and checking in.
Right. And it went long before the 60s and 70s, Greek times, right? Roman times.
Roman times, right.
Yeah. But I think you said something that's really, really key. And I think it captures a lot of what we have been talking about. And that is, if I were to try to sort of, you know, the takeaways that are very, very important, especially for our students to keep with them, self-awareness, self-love makes you far more capable of loving others, makes you far more empathetic also with others. No judgment on yourself or on others, okay? Because we can judge ourselves, and that's where our judgment of others emanates from. And, you know, I'm very grateful to the changes that are happening in our society because of the younger generations represented by our students, right? I mean, I'm always learning to be even more inclusive, to be more considerate. You know, people talk about political correctness. I love the concept of correctness, you know, correct, not because you're politically correct, but because you need to be thinking this way. And I see that in your work, in Daniel's work, sort of evolving. You're not wedded to a conception of love that you bring from the 1970s or the 1980s and you insist on today. This has been fascinating, and I'm going to turn it over to Shannon to say a few words, and then I'll come back to more officially thank you and our audience. Shannon?
Yes, thank you. I have truly enjoyed this engaging discussion about the future of love. We've talked about everything from online dating to non-monogamous relationships, mental health and self-esteem and self-love, gender fluidity, and the definition of modern love. It's been therapeutic for all of us, and we could go on and on for hours on this topic. But as I mentioned earlier, this was the third seminar of the Summer Global Collaboratory, a virtual exchange platform that brings Columbia students, thought leaders, and educators from around the globe together to reflect, ideate, and collaborate to make an impact. And we're looking forward to our next collaboratory seminar in the fall. So please keep an eye out for the announcement. I want to remind Columbia undergraduate students joining us today as well. We look forward to you applying to join the collaboratory in the fall. And thanks again to our esteemed panelists, especially Dr. Judy and Daniel. This has been phenomenal, excuse me. And many thanks to the team at the Columbia Global Centers, Columbia World Projects, Columbia College and the Center for Undergraduate Global Engagement. And of course, we want to extend a very special thank you to our amazing collaboratory students, partners, and participants from around the world. A reminder that a link to the recording of the full webinar will be sent to everyone who registered, and for others, you'll be able to find it on our website. Thank you and be well. Safwan, take it away.
Thank you, Sharon. Thank you. And I think that it was a Freudian slip when you said phenomenon, because Dr. Judy is a phenomenon and Daniel Jones is a phenomenon.
Absolutely.
We're so, so, so grateful. I mean, this has been so much fun. And I just want to echo what Shannon said also and thank our audience, thank our students, but thank August and thank Marika Olson, who's really worked very hard on this, and Karen Poniatchek from Santiago, who piqued our interest in doing something along these lines. Really, we're just incredibly grateful. And Judy, look forward to seeing you on campus. And, we'll talk. I need to talk to you, okay?
We need to hug. And let's point out, Safwan, that you've got your love shirt on.
Absolutely. Love and peace.
I want to thank Chris, who found me to begin with to start all this, which is amazing.
Chris Molinari, who works with Karen in Santiago. Yep. Thank you all very, very, very much. Bye.